Today we complete the ops model. Now last time the result we had was a vortex with perpetual fluctuation, where we saw that if we do not start at the equilibrium point, then there is no other way to reach the equilibrium point. And there we assumed specifically, before starting to find the demarcation lines and their shapes and everything, we assumed that our M, that is our small m, right, that is the rate of growth of money supply, it was considered to be exogenous. Now, a natural question that comes in our mind maybe is that was the perpetual fluctuation observed because we had an exogenous M? Or in other words, if we assume endogenous M, then will the result change? Okay. Because in macro, you will study, or you have studied, things like K percent rule, where money supply is not really exogenous in the sense that it is dependent on some other variable. Okay. Also, as a policy, when do we realize that the money supply must be changed? It depends on other economic variables, right? Okay, so in the first scenario, we are going to assume an endogenous M. So we're going to assume endogenous M. Okay, so that basically means M is dependent on other variables. And here we will write M equal to M of P, where P, as we know, rate of inflation. Okay. And what is the idea? The idea is that excessive money supply generates inflation. So definitely when you have a high inflation rate, it is a good idea to reduce money supply, or the other way around. So let us say that also M dash P is less than zero. So that is, this is a meaningful assumption, right? Okay. Now, let us see that given this structure, that M equal to M of P and M dash P less than zero, what happens to our diagram? We are also, additionally, we will assume one thing. We'll assume that M of P is monotonic in P. Okay. So that means basically that if the rate of inflations are different, then rate of money growth will be different. And not only that, if we have two equal rate of money growth, then it can only happen when the rate of inflations are identical. So that's basically the idea, definition of a monotonicity applying to a function related to macroeconomics. Okay, so now this implies that you see, we had this equation P equal to M of P minus Q, right? So from where we got it? We got it from here, mu dash equal to P plus Q minus M of P into mu, right? So while searching for the demarcation line, which is mu dash equal to zero, we saw that this is the part which is basically what we have drawn as the line, demarcation line corresponding to mu dash equal to zero, right? So earlier we had, for mu dash equal to zero, P equal to M minus Q, where M was exogenous. And that made the whole thing a very specific value of P. So we had a vertical line. Now here, if I say that MP is monotonic in P, then obviously I'll get an equation like this, but it is solvable, but it is solvable for unique P. Okay, because it is monotonic, there will be one unique P for which this equation will become an identity. Okay, so let's just say that solution is some P equal to P1. So what do I mean by that? I mean that if I write P1 in place of P, I will get an identity, right? Okay, now this gives, since this gives a unique value, what will change? What will essentially change? Since this gives a unique value, what will essentially change? So nothing will change, right? So that means our diagram remains the same. Not really the same, but similar. Let us see what will be the difference. Just before drawing, I must mention that in phase diagram drawing, two variable phase diagram, we saw that first we need the demarcation lines, right? And then we need the slopes, that is slope of with respect to the two differential equations. That gives our plus minus, and the rest of it is pretty easy, right? So that's why first we are concerned about the demarcation lines, and the change in M, that is making M endogenous, changes the differential equation of mu dash. But we saw that the demarcation line, that is mu dash equal to zero, it doesn't change much in the sense that it remains a vertical line. So it will remain a vertical line. The only thing that will change here is that now this point will become M of P1 minus Q, right? Okay. So this is our mu dash equal to zero. Rest of it remains same. Because if you calculate the slope, then also you will get mu here, right? Which is positive. So the plus minus symbol here, they remains intact. Okay. And nothing changes in P dash equal to zero. So we got our familiar. We have our familiar vortex. Okay. So we'll have a cycle, right? Which looks like this. So it's basically just the cycle that we have drawn earlier. Now, this says that making M endogenous in the fashion of making it a function of rate of inflation with the assumption that the first order is negative. So when you have a higher rate of inflation, you go for reducing the money supply and vice versa. That really doesn't work. So we have here our old perpetual motion. And again, if you do not start at E, you do not reach E. Okay, now we will move on to Obst prescription, where he also talked about endogenizing M, but not on inflation, which was the earlier idea. he said something different. He said that let us endogenize M, or let us relate M to the change, the rate of change of inflation rate. Okay, so earlier we had inflation rate, and now we are talking about rate of change of inflation rate. So that said, we are essentially talking about the first order of inflation rate. So following Obst prescription, let us say, okay, what will we have? We will have M equal to M of P dash, where M dash of P dash, again, less than zero. So this is usual, but here P dash. So that is rate of change of inflation rate, and not the absolute value of inflation rate. Or rather, I will say that earlier we had rate of change of price level, and now we have moved into rate of change of inflation rate. So we are one step higher in terms of mathematically, in terms of differentiation. Okay. Now let us see. So we will now do the same exercise. First, we'll talk about the demarcation line, and then we'll talk about the slope. And let's see whether it changes our phase diagram or not. So let us start with the demarcation line. As we know that the demarcation line that we will be considering is mu dash equal to zero. So what happens to this? Okay. Now, M equal to, so now for mu dash equal to zero, we have P equal to M of P dash minus Q. So what it first tells us that it is not really solvable for unique P in that sense, right? So it what it says that if I solve it, then I'm not going to get a specific value of P. So no, not specific value of P. Okay, specific means fixed value. So let's just say that that basically means that no vertical line. Now, so no vertical line. So that's what you're trying to say here. You can obviously solve P given a specific structure, but what I'm trying to say is that that will not give us a vertical line because it will change, right? With a change in P, that's P dash, with a change in P, things will change. Now, so what will you do now? Now we need to find the slope of this line. So slope of this line, okay? So naturally our phase diagram, all right? So it had, it goes like this, right? It had mu here and P here. So that was our structure. Now, if I want to draw a line, then the relevant slope will be del mu del P, right? But speaking of this line, there is no mu involved here. I can't see it. So we will go for searching for d mu dP. So let me say it again. We had del mu del P, and we want to draw a line here on that diagram on mu P axis, and we are interested in its slope. So we need to find d mu dP. So for that, we are finding here d mu dP. So what we are trying to do is, instead of doing this d mu dP, we are going to find dP d mu. Okay, so we're going to find dP d mu of this line. Let's do it. So what does it say? M dash P dash, then it will become del P dash del mu, right? And this will become M dash P dash. And from the differential equation of P dash, right, which is H into 1 minus mu, we very well know that, so this from this line, okay, we know that here I will have minus H. All right. Now, here I'll have minus and here I'll have plus. So this slope becomes positive. Okay. All right. So we finish our calculation. So now we can draw our diagram, right? But just before that, since we, with Ops prescription, we do not have our old mu dash equal to zero line, we just want to check the slope in order to find on which side we have minus and on which side we have plus, okay? Okay, so far what we have found? We have found that dp d mu is positive, which tells us that this time mu dash equal to zero is a positively sloped line. Okay, right? All right, now let us see that given that, what happens to the minus and plus? Okay. Now, to the extent of minus and plus, our mu dash remains the same, right? P. Plus q minus m of p dash into mu. Right? That's our mu dash with changed m p dash. Now, if we have this del mu dash del p, then it gives us basically mu, which is positive. So the minus and plus sides remain same. So that means we have our old phase diagram with the only change that this time mu dash equal to zero is positively sloped. So in this miniature, it will be, so our p dash equal to zero will remain the same and mu dash equal to zero this time becomes positively sloped with plus minus at the same point where it was at the same side where it was earlier. Okay. Now, what happens at this equilibrium P? So here we know it is the value one. What happens at this point, right? So to find that, it's very simple. See, at P dash equal to zero, there's no change in P, so P becomes constant, right? So at P dash equal to zero, P becomes a constant. And if P is a constant, then our equation of P equal to M zero, okay, P becomes constant, M zero minus Q. So this gives us the unique value. And why do we put zero here? Because at equilibrium, as we know, at equilibrium, right? At equilibrium, so P dash equal to zero, and this becomes constant, right? So this is our value at E. Okay. All right. So here we will write M zero minus Q. Okay. So let's go through it again a bit. So I've changed our M of P function according to Obst, and that gives us a positively sloped mu dash equal to zero there, okay? And for that, we have, we saw that our del mu dash del P remains intact, so our minus plus sides remain intact. And then at P dash equal to zero, P becomes constant, and that gives our equilibrium value M of zero minus Q. Okay, so now we are going to draw the diagram and see whether this prescription gives us something different from a vortex, and most importantly, whether it becomes stable or not. Okay, because it is the question of stability that is taking us from one policy to another, right? We don't want perpetual fluctuation or never ceasing inflation. That's why we are changing the structure or policy regarding growth of money supply. Okay, so now this becomes our diagram. So P here, mu here, it remains just like earlier. And here it remains mu dash equal to zero. So minus plus here, this is one. So the directional arrows, they remains unchanged if we take region 1, 2, 3, and 4, right? Okay. So that much we can directly take from our earlier diagram. Okay. Now, if we choose an arbitrary point, okay, so here it goes, and here it goes like this. You see, the slopes has changed, so the movement, it has changed. And now if you rotate it from here, because that in, it is in this direction that it will move, okay. All right. Okay. So let's just make it a bit clearer. Okay. So here we have our trajectories for the changed phase diagram, right? And here we have our value and E. Now, here in this diagram, what is it? This becomes, so let us be right here. This is a stable focus. Right. Okay, so this means instead of making M exogenous or making M dependent on change in price, instead of doing this, okay, or rather I'll write it like this. So instead of doing this, if I make it dependent on the rate of inflation, okay, and obviously how do I behave? I behave like this. If I do this, then our problem of never ceasing inflation, it finishes. You start from an arbitrary point and in stable focus, okay, what happens? You eventually reach E. All right. So one trick about the diagram is this, that now, see, now it has to, now it has to come to E, right? So this means that the, that for a single trajectory, for a single trajectory, the distance at which it becomes, it crosses the demarcation lines, okay, that point, its distance from E, it reduces sequentially. So here it is very, the distance is quite big, then it becoming smaller, then much, then it is again smaller than the old one, right? And here it becomes even smaller. So with every passing of the demarcation lines, the distance of that tangent from E, it reduces. Remember this while drawing the diagram. That is the trick to draw a stable focus, and obviously it comes to E. All right, so we have solved our problem. So we have removed the problem of having a focus. So we have eliminated perpetuity. But there is one little problem, that we have eliminated perpetuity asymptotically. Okay. So we have eliminated perpetuity asymptotically. So with time going to infinity, it will obviously reach E. Anyways, so while solving the problem, you may get the sense that moving from a vortex to a stabilized system, okay, the trick, mathematical trick, was to change the, so change this mu dash equal to whatever it is suitably so that we can get a stable structure. And if you think on that line, then it is correct. That's what you do. And that's what you did. Even not only that, if we can make this mu dash sufficiently flatter, because that's what we exactly did, right? So earlier we had mu dash vertical like this and p dash there like horizontal, right? So now what is happening? If this is mu dash, it is becoming flatter. Okay, so and given it is becoming flatter, we are having a stable equilibrium. Now, let me just say this, that for sufficiently flat mu dash equal to zero, you can have a stable node. You can have a stable node. And what is the advantage? I mean, at least from the point of view of, you know, in practical world, having a monetary policy which is, which does not come with never ceasing inflation, having a stable node, what is the advantage of having a stable node? It is that every path for a stable node, from any arbitrary point, you choose a path and you reach E. Okay, so that's where we complete the Hopf's model. Okay, so just to say, he said that our conventional policy style or making or the conventional policy of monetary policy, which connected it, the money supplies change to the change of price, is not really good, given there is an inflation adjustment mechanism. Okay, so that's very important. Given there is an inflation adjustment mechanism. What he said is that if there is an inflation adjustment mechanism at work, then why not connect the rate of growth of money supply to rate of change of inflation? And in that way, we can have a dynamically stable system. Okay.